What I need you to do first and foremost, put brotherlife45@gmail.com. Let's do this. Let me get this out the way. Peace to the family. I'm happy to be here. Happy that you've made this acquaintance. Right? And this is what we're doing today. It's a new phone, so it won't pop up once you type in a few words. Right? Glad that you guys are here. You're about to do some serious work. How you doing? Okay, we got 511 people in the building already. You know my motto, we gotta hit that 1,000 mark. I don't want thousands of you coming in saying, asking me questions that I already discussed. We go through this all the time. So what I do now, I wait till a good 1,000 of you come in there, and then at least 1,000 people in there can catch some people up in the text so they can start distracting me. Because, you know, I want to start the whole damn thing over, you know. Hey, I like to build. We're building. What's the number count? Where we at?
851.
851. Come on, people. Come on. Come on. We got, what, 149 more to go? Come on.
It's 945.
945. Come on. Do I hear 1,000? Come on. Stop. We're going to do the auction. Once we hit 1,000.
1,000.
There we go. Time to work. It's time to work. I want y'all to know how powerful this is. And y'all need to understand. I got some slides that's really going to attest to this. That's power. The world that we live in today. Imagine if Malcolm X or Marcus Garvey or Che Guevara. Imagine if these people were able Harriet Tubman, right? That whole Underground Railroad would have been another thing if we had social media. Just imagine if Elijah, most honorable Elijah Muhammad had social media. Just imagine if Assata Shakur had social media. I was able to organize you, 1,000 of you, within the first, what, minute of this broadcast? And y'all are from all over the world. What I want y'all to do is type in what part of the world you're from. What number are we on right now?
It's 1,300.
Okay, 1,300. I want y'all to type in what part of the world you're in right now. What city, what state, what province, what country. And then I'm going to get going. I'm just doing this to make sure I get enough of you guys in there. I do like the videos to start promptly. But we here. What's the countries that they're saying right now? That's also my
Dallas, soundtrack. Texas, California, Michigan. Texas.
Where at? Where else?
Somersville, South Carolina.
Where else you guys are from?
North Carolina.
There we go.
Tennessee.
Go ahead. Give
South Carolina, another one.
There we
Maryland.
Go. Maryland. Come on, we east
UAN,
and west.
California.
Okay, California stepping up.
That's Houston, good. Texas.
Texas.
Richmond, course. Virginia.
VA.
Detroit, we Michigan.
We're going to do the roll call at the end. I'm waiting for you out of Thomas, man. When you
Mississippi.
Still you still on your flight, UK? Come on, UK, tell me something.
Atlanta, Georgia.
There we go. There
Puerto
we go.
Rico. Okay.
Puerto Rico, there we go. Shout out to the Puerto Ricans, man. Bienvenido a la casa. Come on now, talk to me.
Another more, Houston, Texas, North Carolina, Dallas, Texas.
And that's what I'm saying.
Oklahoma.
Shout out to the people that's out the country watching the live. Ain't that powerful?
You got New York in here now.
We got Puerto Rican family watching. So we are all united electronically. That is powerful.
And you're at 2K.
We at 2,000. Now we can go. You got to get a roll call. Because I swear to you, maybe like 2,000 people saying, so where we at with it? Distracting the first 1,000 that was there. So at least we got the first 2,000 in there. We're going to get ready to go. You know, I love you. I have to say that. You need to know that this is done in love. And the reason why I say that is because if you, and this is not to knock nobody, if you were to compare and contrast, first of all, people don't do PowerPoint presentations like this. Turn the crib into an office space and just go to work to deliver information, close this up only for people to say, yo, where's part three? Because people already asked me for part three on Instagram. I'm like, fam, give me 24 hours to let this marinate, to let the other 100,000+ people catch up. You know, I like to give it at least a 24-hour space. But I appreciate the listening because we're in a beautiful day and time where we can organize electronically like this, virtually like this. And there's power in that. And we're going to talk about that in lessons to come. So I actually got this it's a five-part series that we'll be doing on what's taking place today. And the reason why it has to be compartmentalized like that is because you gotta understand that the risk that's at, the threat that's here, you know, people are laid off, are not getting any recompense, but they're letting you know where you can go shop. Now, if you're not making no money, where are you gonna go shopping? Two people are panic shopping. What does that mean? The bus will run dry very soon. And then we're seeing guns are at an all-time high being sold in America right now. Who's buying these guns? These are questions that have to be dealt with, but more especially, there's a pot of gold at the end of every crisis. I'll say it again. There's a pot of gold at the end of every crisis. You good, right?
I'm trying to put the phone on silent because people are texting you and the sound is...
Alerts, you should be able to... Sorry, I was in...
Alerts generally... Hold on. Resume. Okay, 2,600. Generally, when you touch volume, there we go. If you touch volume and you click this, notifications, boom. Should be good now. Okay, we at 2,600.
Do we got 3,000? Oh yeah, everybody, do me a favor, share the video. You're gonna wanna show this to your family in real time. Do me a favor, share this video right now. Take a little time, you're not gonna miss nothing. Share it, not to one person, to several people. You always say, what can I do to help with the movement? What can I do to contribute to the movement? This is what we say all the time. And everybody say, I ain't got all the money to fund the movement, but I ain't asking you for money, I'm asking you for your service. Share the video, it's the best thing you can do so we can spread the information. Because if I was doing some Negro activity, if I was disrespecting the black woman, if I was degrading women in general, if I was over here soliciting lyrics to sell drugs in my community, I wouldn't have no issue with that being shared. I wouldn't even have to say share this. We would share the worst of our kind before the world. But we won't share the information that saves us or represents us at best. So I'm asking everybody, make a concerted effort to share the video with somebody else you know on Facebook, more than one person. When it's over, and even right now, if you can, if you know how to do it, share the video, that's very important. Okay, what numbers are we at right now?
2,900.
I'm gonna start for the 3,000 because again, I don't wanna have thousands of people asking what's going on, but this is what we need to do. I want you to understand we're dealing with this from an economic level because there is a, we have 3,000? 3,000, there we go. It's on now, it's on. What happens is, there's a pot of gold at the end of every crisis. See the crisis as the rainbow. Doesn't happen often. It ain't often you see a rainbow. Even when it rains, we don't see the rainbow. And when we do see it, it's kind of opaque, it's a little obscure. But today, I'm telling you, the rainbow's out there. And it's kind of mythical, so this whole crisis thing is kind of mythical because in my generation in particular, we might have felt it in New York with the blizzard of 96. I still remember that because school was out and I enjoyed it thoroughly. But as an adult, they didn't like it, okay? And so we living in a real zombie apocalypse right now. It's going to get worse before it gets better. But what I want you to understand is a lot of people are going to come out of this impoverished. And a lot more people, a lot of people are going to come out of this wealthy, but a lot more people are gonna come out impoverished. There's some people that no matter what is transpiring, they will come out on top because that's how they wire. And those who know don't tell, and those who tell certainly don't know, quite often. On very rare occasions do you find people that actually have some knowledge that can incentivize or at least deliberate in ways to encourage the behavior of saving yourselves. So this is the save yourself package. These 1 to 5 videos, I will not hit you in your head with just doomsday talks and speculations about martial law and people going to come out with guns and people going to rob you and all that. That might be true, but I'm not here solely to talk to you about that. The main thing I'll talk to you about is the pot of gold at the end of every crisis. There's an advantage at every crisis, and you need to know about this and come to terms with it. But the first thing we gotta do is make sure we get your major concerns out. And that's why I came up with coronavirus, technological, and microbiome warfare. What's the number count last time?
3.6K.
3.6K. So this is enough people in the classroom. We're all in our homes in the same class. Think about the power in that. Think about the power in that. I want you to understand that I had a program called G5 when I did this debate. Is the white man the devil? Have we become our own worst enemy? And I said the white man is not my devil. That's giving somebody too much power. I give nobody that power over me, because if I can't provide food, clothing, shelter to my wives and children, I can't say the reason why I can't is because the white man, because I'm selling them over to another race. I might as well tell my wife, go marry this white man, because of him I can't do, and he definitely can do for you, because he's the reason I'm doing for you. I can't do that. But what I did was something very important. I proposed that for the people that was calling me a coon, for the people that was calling me a crossover nigga, for the people that was calling me an Uncle Tom, and if you do the knowledge about Uncle Tom is actually the good guy. So that's how I know we dealing with uneducated people when they spew these negative names or they castigate you for having a difference in opinion. Nonetheless, I said, here's the proposition. What if, because America has experience with 27 million people in this populace, and black people in general make up about 14% of that populace. I said, certainly, out of the whole populace that makes up or accounts for black people, it has to be over 30 million, but after 30 million plus people, I said, certainly we can find 10,000 people that say the white man is the devil, that have $5 that they could consecrate, put into their savings on a week-to-week basis, which would be $20 a month, $5 a week. And if we did this with just 10 months, not 12, that it accumulates to how much money? $2 million. So I said, is it really the white man holding you back? I say this because just think about the possibilities. If right now while we're on this live, what's the number count?
3.8K.
We're going to hit the 4,000. By the time we're done, it'll probably be 5,000. Just think about the possibilities. If 10,000 people that agreed with each other, we know there's more than 10,000 people in America that's black that agree with each other about something in particular. We know that people, our people, when I say black, you know we're encompassing Puerto Ricans, Dominicans, Colombians. I don't give a damn if you say Dominicans don't feel they black. I know many of them that know we are all part of the same grouping genetically. We all come out of Africa. We know this shit. I ain't got no time to play games with you. I ain't concerned with that. What I'm concerned with is this. 10,000 of us agree about many things. And if we started grouping ourselves in increments of 10,000, $5 a week, $20 a month, and 10 months, every 10 months we have $2 million. What's holding any group of 10,000 of us back? Because right now on this one live, spontaneously, that you did not know I was going to go live. You did not know I was going to go live. And we damn near half that amount of money. So we would be at what, $1 million? In 10 months? $5 a week? Shit, $2.50 a week. And so we don't make our quota of 10,000 people. We only make a quota of 5,000 people. We don't make the quota of $5 a week. We make the quota of $2.50 a week. We still wind up at $500,000 every 10 months. What's holding us back? Our lack of unity. Every money don't solve every problem, but it'll solve most of them. I ain't never gonna lie to you. I ain't never gonna lie to you. So we gonna have that conversation. When you see us doing them credit restoration microwaves for $3,000, why I gotta pay $3,000? Because we're removing 30,000, jackass. You know I gotta keep it 100 with you. We're removing $100,000. And not only are we removing a debt that you will normally die with, you know that's why they have shit called mortgage. For those people that are going to bankruptcy, because a mortgage is what? Mort means death. Gage means pledge your agreement. So this is a pledge your agreement till you die. The average person doesn't buy a house until they're about age 35 or so. You do a 30-year fixed rate mortgage, you'll be 65 by the time you're done. The reason why it's a mortgage or a pledge your agreement until you die is because of what? Because the mortality rate, the lifetime expectancy of the average man is 72 years old, especially if you're in a black community. Latino, Hispanic, however they want to call it, your lifetime expectancy as a man is 72, and the woman got a few more years on top of you. So if you get a 30-year fixed rate mortgage and walk into that house at the average age of 35 by the time you tend to get a house, you'll be on your way out by the time you're on your way in the damn house. It's expected for you to die, and then if you don't know how to protect your asset, your shit goes into probate. Because you ain't got to trust another setup. Let me talk to you. And that's why we have these programs set up. That's why, and right now, you don't even realize this is the most ideal time to purchase a property or renegotiate before closing. And that window has a crevice of space because these lenders is looking to back out and see if they can eliminate mortgages right now, because it is at an advantage point for you right now in this crisis. Right now, you can win. Right now, 40 grand, 80 grand, 100 grand be deducted from what you would normally pay. Refinancing will happen in real time. Right now for you. You're going to have to wait the duration of time that traditionally they tell you have to wait. All of these advantages are here for you because of this coronavirus. Now, to go over some statistics and just show you how people can shake the foundation of our lives socioeconomically. I'm not telling you that the virus is fake. The virus is real. I got a PowerPoint coming out tomorrow that's going to show you the scientists that have been working on curing coronavirus for years. On national television, you might have missed what I said. They've been working on curing coronavirus for years. Masters and experts of coronavirus. So people say, like, what gives you the right to talk about coronavirus? You're not a master expert. I have the right to let you know that the masters and experts have been working on it for years. And in case you haven't caught what I said, years as in plural, on CNN or C-SPAN, I will show you the reference, live television. And I'm saying, is anyone realizing they keep using years like plural? So you didn't know about this, but suddenly you worry about it now and suddenly it's spreading? It wasn't spreading when you were studying it for years ago? Gotta keep everyone's claim to fame who doesn't know much is saying, oh, there's a different one. This is the novel coronavirus. And I said, yeah, bro, what does novel coronavirus mean? You're talking about the human coronavirus. This is the novel one. I say, yo, you gotta understand when people put information out there to make you think that you sound heavy, but when you talk to someone that knows better, you sound like a goddamn idiot. Don't talk to me like that. I'm actually studying this. You just pick that up. You can't microwave information before the type that studies it for years. Let's move. Let's go. Let's get into this. So the first thing I want you to do is this. And you go to brotherforlife45@gmail.com if you're interested in the credit restoration microwave. That's when we remove all your negative items off your report. Okay, we delete all the negative items off your report. We boost your TransUnion Spammer, Equifax, Advantage FICO score, and then we leverage the results from boosting those scores, okay, and opportunities are abound at that point between credit cards, personal loans, business loans, and the likes. Okay, you get your access to monies you ain't never had at your disposal before. These are facts. You leave your full name and number. All we got, consultations. We'll talk about all of that at the end, but right now I gotta get to the work. This is Facebook, so now I ain't gotta rush when I'm on Instagram and get everything out of my head inside of 10 minutes. Now I got a little time, I can throw behind the back pass, put the ball through my leg, slam dunk. I can do a couple things on Facebook, but nonetheless, I'm gonna run through this presentation right now for y'all and give y'all a little extra that wasn't on Instagram. So let's get ready to go. Let's cook. So let's do the math. The CDC predicts that at least 12,000 Americans will die from the flu in any given year. As many as 61,000 people die in the 2017-2018 flu season. And 45 million people were infected. Let's do this again. As many as 61,000 people died in 2017 and 2018 during flu season. As many as 61,000 people died. This is from USNews.com, just so you see the reference. Just so you see the reference, okay? Just so you know. It's supposed to be credible. This is USNews.com. You watch the news, and they're the ones that got you in a frenzy with the information, right? So I'm giving you news references, since these are the people. These are the culprits that get us going around running crazy. 61,000 people died. We ain't hear nothing about this, right? And 45 million people were infected. 45 million. Let's go down here. Okay, now article dated February 10th, 2020 by Simon Mori of Maryland. What is sparking fear of the novel coronavirus? According to the latest reports from the U.S. Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, CDC, influenza has caused the deaths of between 10,000 and 25,000 Americans, hospitalized 180,000, and sickened 19 million so far in the 2019 to 2020 season. At this time, which was February 10th, 2020 of this year, this is in that context, coronavirus, on the other hand, has killed about 900 people. Of course, the toll is higher worldwide. There have been only a handful of cases in the United States with no deaths reported. So why is the public so panicked over the outbreak? Think about these numbers. 61,000 people died 2017-2018 in America from flu season. The average is normally around 31,000, according to WHO, the World Health Organization. And 45 million people were infected. 45 million people were infected by this. While this goes on, 19 million people was infected by what? Influenza. So these are two different things. And it was 10,000 deaths. 10,000 to 25 Americans, between 10,000 to 25,000 Americans died. So over here, 61,000 people died from flus in general, and 10 to 20,000 from specifically influenza. 19 million from influenza, 45 million people in general were affected by flu. 900 people at this point, February 10, 2020, we was at an epidemic. Right now it's called a pandemic. It starts off as an outbreak. Measles was on the verge of being a pandemic last year. Okay? So what I'm saying is, somebody opted in to make this the pandemic. When these numbers reek of pandemic, and we lived through this, and we haven't heard none of this last year, in 2017, 2018, and 2019. So this is the part I didn't get to go over on Instagram. Novel coronavirus 2019, NCOV, has some obvious differences from influenza virus. The first difference is that we do not understand how the virus will transform itself via mutations to become more contagious in the future. The outbreak is similar to severe acute respiratory syndrome, SARS virus, which was initially transmitted from animals to humans and believed to have originated from civet, cats, and bats. Coronavirus, like SARS virus, typically causes zoonotic infections being transmitted from animals to humans. Listen closely. One way that these viruses are suspected of getting into the human population is when they are eaten as exotic foods or taken as medicines. Let's do it again. One way that these viruses are suspected of getting into the human population is when they are eaten as exotic foods or taken as medicines. Think about it. Typically found in Asian countries like China, in many ways, the coronavirus and SARS virus are similar. Let's go to the next slide. Technology and immunity. And right here, I just want y'all to realize microwaves, these are all the non-ionizing waves on a spectrum that's supposed to not implicate us biologically. Okay? What we need?
I'm saying you still want this way or landscape view? It'll just
this way. Facebook ain't gonna do it the way we want it.
Okay.
Microwave, what I wanna show you is that the microwaves and the cell phones exist in the same spectrum. They will tell you that the cell phones is not causing no problems with you biologically. But they don't let you know the microwave implication biologically and that you can't have women that's conceived and standing in front of the microwave. So which one is it? Because we're here in the same non-ionizing spectrum. But we'll go forward. Let's go to the next slide. And watch what happens here. Radio frequency waves possibly carcinogenic to humans, meaning cancerous. We look at this part right here. The working group published a summary of their findings, The Lancet Oncology. Now what's going on here? The scientists looked at one cohort study and five case control studies in humans, each of which was designed to investigate whether there's a link between cell phones, also interpretation between mobile phone, radio frequency, and electromagnetic frequency exposure in glioma is possible. Smaller studies supported a similar conclusion for acoustic neuroma, but the evidence was not convincing for the other types of cancer. Let's go back. Okay, let's move forward now. Boom. Do it again. Boom. Get us this next slide. Bring that back up.
Yep.
Next slide. Millimeter waves is what this is about. Okay, boom. Right here. So, what I want you to realize, okay, I had the link right here, but technology and immunity, if you type in radio frequency waves, possibly carcinogenic to humans, in 2011, 30 international scientists who are part of a working group of the International Agency of Research on Cancer. Boom. If you type this in, you pull up this information, or you type in Lancet Oncology, L-A-N-C-E-T, Oncology. Look up the report, okay? Look at the scientific findings. Look up this case study. And what you're going to see is that they found that glioma, which is a cancer of the central nervous system, was brought about from being subject to radio frequency in terms of phones. Okay, this is radio frequency. Okay, well watch this, let's keep going. We're gonna go to the next one. Once you understand something. High-grade glioma mimicking acute viral encephalitis. What does this mean? Glioma, the cancer of the central nervous system, is mimicking a virus, meaning it can be misinterpreted as a virus, and this viral disposition is called encephalitis. So gliomas mimicking acute viral encephalitis. So she remained persistent, and you see the date of the article. Here's the citations. Okay, here's the site. She remained persistently confused with frequent, simple, and complex partial seizures. 1 month later, MR guided stereostatic biopsy of the left temporal lobe. So the main thing we want to realize when you read this article, on your time, you do the research, here's the reference point right here, you'll find that glioma mimics acute viral encephalitis. So I asked myself here, I said, hold on. They say radio frequencies and electromagnetic frequencies don't affect the body, doesn't implicate the body, even though that we know microwaves exist in the same spectrum as far as non-ionizing fields. But they say the microwaves can implicate us, but they say that the cell phones don't, but the cell phones is right there in the same spectrum. Fine. We say this. They say, yo, you're dealing with conspiracy theories if you think the phones have any... Well, you're saying the phones is causing the virus. I'm saying the phones is breeding grounds or precipitates the event, or the phones are the leverage or the segue to which end our immunity is compromised, and it's easier for the viruses to invade the human body because it destabilizes the central nervous system. Well, now we found through an actual scientific study, that the central nervous system undergoes cancer on account of these radio frequencies. We also found out that the type of cancer called glioma mimics a virus called encephalitis, meaning it's hard to differentiate if we're looking at a virus or if we're looking at the impact of the central nervous system being compromised via glioma, the cancer of the central nervous system, because they look identical. So, radio frequencies, cancer, glioma mimics virus. Hard to make a distinction if a virus had, if the body is being subject to a virus, or if it's a cancer that's brought about through the radio frequencies. Let's go to the next slide. So the next question is, what does this have to do with what? The coronavirus. Well, as we do the research on encephalitis, we find that coronavirus and encephalitis, per the Encephalitis Society, the symptoms are similar to other illnesses that are much more common, such as cold and flu. If you think you may have COVID-19, you read the rest of the article. But the main thing that I want you to see is coronavirus and encephalitis look alike. So, radio frequencies, cell phone frequencies, 5G, which is what we're going to go to, can bring about a cancer to the central nervous system called glioma that mimics the viral encephalitis, the virus encephalitis, that mimics coronavirus, meaning if P implies Q and Q implies P and P implies R, then R also implies Q. That's the law of implication. This is intention calculus. So, but we know that this is always going to be consistent. So what we're going to do, we can't say if the Knicks beat the Bulls and the Bulls beat the Lakers, that means the Knicks can beat the Lakers. That's the law of implication, doesn't mean that it's always right. But the law of double implication reversal would tell us what? If dogs are mammals and all mammals are warm-blooded, then all dogs are warm-blooded. That's going to be right all the time. This is the dogs that are warm-blooded and the mammals. If radio frequencies can impact the central nervous system to the point you get cancer of the central nervous system called glioma, and the glioma mimics the virus encephalitis, and encephalitis looks identical to coronavirus, then it's safe to reason that cell phone or radio frequencies can be misinterpreted as far as the impact it has on us biologically as coronavirus. Doesn't mean coronavirus doesn't exist. Doesn't mean that. Doesn't mean that at all. One of two things we can deduce: it can be misinterpreted or misappropriated as far as information, one thing for the other. Or two, your body, because of a reduced central nervous system, can be more subject to that virus than others alike. These are two things we can deduce. This is about logic, people. This is P implies Q, Q implies R. If R implies Q, then R may also imply P. But this is not the Knicks beat the Bulls beat the Lakers, so therefore the Knicks should be able to beat the Lakers. That's not logical. That's the law of implication. A lot of variables are there. Different players may play, different chemistry. they're always going to win all the time. But if a dog is a mammal and all mammals are warm-blooded, then all dogs are warm-blooded. And that is the law of double implication reversal, and it will be right all of the time. So I'm a logical man. I'm a man that deals with logic. Mathematically, it's called sentential calculus. So I'm not going to play games with you guys and speculate like a conspiracy theorist. I'm not wired to think like that. There's also the law of disjunctive inference. There's also the law of the contrapositive. There's also the law of contradiction. I'm wired to know if you got two is, an and, an or within one or two sentences, what that's likely to be. And it doesn't work to your favor for me as a debater. Okay? I'm wired not to just jump to conclusions. Let's go to the next one. Technological advancement and viral pandemics run concurrent. Drop the ball on them right now. In 1894 to 1895, Marconi developed the first practical radio transmitter receivers. Radio waves became commercial in 1900s. In the 1900s, we start seeing commercial use of radio waves. What happened? In 1918, the Spanish flu. This was a pandemic. First you have outbreaks, then you have epidemics, then you have pandemics. That is the highest. That is the height of the outbreak. That is the height of the epidemic, the pandemic. So we've seen pandemics on account of Spanish flu in the 1918s, and we've seen not too long from the introduction of planet Earth being enveloped with radio waves, because you have to set it up so everybody can transmit messages. When the planet Earth started being enveloped with radio waves, Spanish flu came about a few years after. We don't play the game with coincidence. It's just, we just pyramid and emphasis until which time we can actually definitively conclude that we might be on to something. So go to the next one. Hong Kong flu. Now we're talking about radar signals. We got to remember World War II people. And you got to understand that when you see this technology, think about it on a quantum scale. When we get introduced technology, see, I can put this on Instagram. When we get introduced technology, you have to understand that the countries deal with it on a quantum scale. So if you see radar technology, understand that the countries like China and America are competing on a quantum radar level. So when they're enveloping the world with radar technology, they are also militaristically anticipating attacks on a quantum radar level because they're building it up on that level. They give you one rendition of the technology and they quantify it on their end. You use quantum technology like to pierce through stealth. So if somebody has a mechanism flying that normally goes off the radar, it's because they quantize the information or the energy, which means it's amplified beyond our conventional comprehension. So what I'm saying is, when we say, oh, 5G technology, you saying that's causing this, I'm saying it's quantified. If they give you that technology at their disposal, if they let us have this technology at our disposal, do you think they're letting the common man and woman have equal technology rights? The man that's carrying the 5G signal walking around here, or carrying a mechanism that can use the 5G millimeter wavelength signal, do you think that countries are like, hey, let's give the populace access to the same exact technology we've given them permission to use? Or do you think they already have an ample amount of the same thing at their disposal and they give you a watered down rendition of the same? So don't get this twisted. Oh, 5G technology, I'm telling you that quantified. Because they have to envelope the planet for them to use it militaristically, and also for you to use it on a minuscule or a microcosmic scale. This is not speculation. No one in power is going to give its laity the same amount of power. Like, no one who creates an educational system, the Rockefellers, the curriculum, as you know it, they're not going to create a curriculum where people of lesser power and understanding can eventually be educated to compete with their children for power. No one does this. Would you do it? Would you see to it that people can fairly compete to take your children's blood right away from them? Whether you stole it or you inherited, no one's going to teach another people how to take their power. I hope this makes sense. It's not random speculations. It's that sentential calculus again. Okay? I want y'all to really take this into consideration. So, what we saw was the Spanish flu. Okay? On account of radio waves when they were introduced. Now we see the Hong Kong flu. We're in the same place. Spanish flu was in China. Hong Kong is in China. They seceded China. They want to be their own people now, their own entity. That was as of 1997. But at this time, they was a part of China. And they ain't go nowhere. That's just politics. They're still part of China, geographically. Okay? So, what I want you to understand is, in 1964, they upped the ante on the radar technology and created the Doppler radar. They came with another blanket over the planet Earth with the radar technology in 1964. And look what happened in 1968. Hong Kong flu was not just an outbreak, was not just an epidemic, but it was a pandemic in China yet again. Let's go to the next slide. Here we are again. The coronavirus has its inception where? In China, yet again. Spanish flu, Hong Kong flu, coronavirus, epidemic, pandemic, pandemic, and pandemic again. Pandemic after pandemic in the same place that constantly is in competition with America for technology. And in the world in general, China has been on the internet intermittently since May 1989 and on a permanent basis since the 20th of April, 1994. In 2008, China became the country with the largest population on the internet. China, the largest population on the internet. And the world's leader in 5G technology, because when America told you you had 5G and you look at your phones and you see 5G, you didn't have 5G. And if you don't believe me, look at the hoopla now. Yo, about to have 5G networks. Go to T-Mobile right now. 5G network. We're about to be the first one in America with 5G. Excuse me. We've been walking around here the last 2-3 years thinking we had 5G. How is it you just talking to us now, acting like you ain't lied to us the last 2-3 years? Now it's a big thing. 5G is coming, and the speed is going to be off the chain. Hold on. That wasn't 5G what we had this whole time? Because my old phone still says 5G. You see what I'm saying? They do this because they're competing. China is the only country that's been using 5G, and they got the largest internet populace. So yet another frequency. We went from radio frequency to radar frequency to now 5G. Okay? And not only that.
Can that focus? It's a little blurry.
Not only that, they've been dealing with 7G and 10G. So, nuke Korea, North America, and Korea, China, 10G circuits launched in August. Openness ceremony planned for September 5th to September 6th, 2005. Look at this. They've been talking about 10G since 2005. We just really coming to terms with 5G, and China has the largest internet populace around the world. And yet again, when a new frequency is enveloped over the planet, meaning they have to set up all sorts of towers all over again, so signals can be transmitted all over the world. They gotta blanket the earth with the frequencies so they can be relayed. It has to take place everywhere. China has it already on that level. And we seen by way of Guglielmo what the radio frequencies do and how that cancer mimics encephalitis as a virus. And that virus encephalitis looks almost identical as far as symptoms are concerned and functionality as the coronavirus. You walk with me? So this is not random guesses. So people don't make you feel like you're in this conspiracy theorist. And I always say the conspiracy theorists, you know who they are? The conspiracy theorists are the conspiracy theorists. And I know that sounds like an oxymoron. The people who scream conspiracy theorists are the actual conspiracy theorists. Because these are the weirdos that, despite all the facts you present, they, man, just leave the conspiracy alone. You saying the virus is, Negro, did I not just show you a whole PowerPoint presentation? The conspiracy theorists, you know what they do? They don't give you facts, they don't give you sources, they don't substantiate their claims. So who's really the conspiracy theorist? The people calling people that's giving you the facts, conspiracy theorists. Because when you ask the people that say, oh man, you just always deal with conspiracy, you say, bro, Do you have any facts to substantiate why you're saying what you're saying versus why I'm saying what I'm saying? Because I'm actually giving you details. I'm giving you sources. And the only thing you're doing is opening your mouth and saying conspiracy. People do this because it makes them feel smart. Rather than have to do the research, they would rather just chalk it off as someone making an error, and that's it. And they get to go back and go to sleep again and entrust the media, who they never asked for their credentials. And you say, yo, are you a medical professional? Are you a medical professional reporter? Why are you giving us this information if you're not a medical professional? But they would demand that of us, as if we don't have to be subject to the same sources as the media that presents information to you. And even when I take their media and show you, you still want to know about my credentials, but you never ask the media who put those people there to scare the shit out of you that. But it's okay. We don't appeal to people for the purposes of proving them wrong. We appeal to the people to establish what you may deem as right for you. This is not a tug of war. You know, Dr. John Henry Clark said, you know, in regards to debate, he doesn't, and I'm paraphrasing, he doesn't debate with the fools, he only debates with his equals. And I'm paraphrasing to let you know, because I ain't saying exactly what he said. You know, he only debates with his equals. There's no debate. Let's go to the next slide. Not when it comes to this stuff. So now we got to talk about something called CRISPR. Understand, what is CRISPR? These are clusters, regularly interspaced, short palindromic repeats. CRISPR. What does that have to do with anything? This is how viruses get beat. What does that have to do with you? Bacteria and viruses been gangbanging since time immemorial. This is your blood and crypt. They've been gangbanging for ages. They both seek to replicate themselves. You even gotta go back to school and find out what a eukaryotic cell and a prokaryotic cell is, but I'm not gonna beat you in the head before that, though I would love to. Let's just call this bacteria, let's call this virus, what? A parasite with instructions. Because we're talking about DNA and RNA, we're talking about instructions and tools. But the virus only has the instructions. Then we go to the bacteriophage, right? There's a difference between bacteriophage and bacteria, but walk with me. I wanted the bacteriophage here, okay? The most popular one you should know is the phage lambda, but that's another conversation. So we go here and we'll find that the bacteria, which is a single cell organism, has instructions and it has tools. Now we said this CRISPR right here, this clustered, regularly interspaced, short palindromic repeat. I gotta do a class on that in itself. We're going to, this is gonna be fun. It's gonna be fun, because we don't get taught this in school. So because we're not taught this in school, when people go on the news and they tell you about a virus, you don't even know how to categorize viruses, nor do you know how to defend yourself against it. So you're getting disinfectants and all sorts of glass cleaner and everything, and you're losing your goddamn mind. Not knowing that part of the strategy is to make you do things to make you sick. So everyone is going to feel like they've been touched by this damn flu one way or the other, but the words common cold keeps coming up every time we talk about this goddamn flu. And we're in flu season. Because April showers bring May flowers, and a lot of you people, because you got so much mucus in your body, you got these allergic responses called sinuses. And if you stayed in ocean water enough, it would clean your sinuses and you'd realize you wouldn't have no sinus problems. But that's another conversation because, you know, I'm just a conspiracy theorist, right? You need somebody who has paper stuck up there to tell you, take the chemotherapy because I'm a doctor. But for some reason, my sister and I was rewarded money because the chemotherapy killed my mother and I would have had more time with her, and it was proven that my mother's children would have had more time with each other had she not taken the chemotherapy. So for some reason, my sister and I was rewarded money when I was young, because I had 7 days with my mother. Because I was ignorant, and shit, I took the word of the person who went to school and got the degree. Right? Because we do know if you been walking with me, what pharmacy is. In Greek, pharmacy is what? Pharmakeia. And what does pharmakeia mean? Well, if you go in the Bible, anywhere you see witchcraft or sorcery, if you go into it in the Greek, it's the word pharmakeia, from which the word pharmacy derives. So pharmacy, out of all words for us to establish what pharmaceuticals would be, why would you graft a word that represents our medicine as sorcery or witchcraft? Out of all words you could have used, we go into this word etymologically and see it's a Greek word, pharmakeia, which means sorcery or witchcraft. That's what the medicine, that's what the medicine institution is all about, witchcraft and sorcery. And you go to Rite Aid, which is the drugstore, and Rite Aid is spelled not R-I-G-H-T like it's the right thing to do, it's spelled R-I-T-E as in ritual. So you go to the pharmacy, which is sorcery or witchcraft in Greek, amongst all words, etymologically the word pharmacy goes to pharmakeia. And if you go in the Bible, anywhere you see witchcraft or sorcery, it's the word pharmacy. And then we go to Rite Aid Pharmacy, the ritual, and what do you need for the ritual? Well, when you conduct a sorcery or witchcraft, you got to get all these things together, right? So we get a vaccine. Most vaccines have formaldehyde, dead baby fetuses, mercury, the second most poisonous thing on planet Earth. That should sound like witchcraft, because I don't need no dead baby fetuses to make me feel better. You can look these things up now. But you got the Negroes saying, they don't put mercury inside of vaccines. That's a lie. They come up with different names euphemistically because they understand how offensive or how much it implicates them in their agenda to facilitate this task to put it in your body. Just like monosodium glutamate is known by 14 other misnomers. Like monopotassium glutamate. What it does, it tricks the brain into thinking that what you just ate was so delicious that you want it again. It's used a great deal in Chinese food. And when Chinese food came into the country, autism came into the country, ran concurrent. When Chinese food comes in, autism comes in. Monosodium glutamate. But it's on the back of your potato chips bags, most of them, as monopotassium glutamate. If you can't catch up with that, they got 13 other names for you. But you trust these people with your life, because they got a damn table on top of the wall. You trust them with your mama, and they failed you. You trust them with your daddy, and they failed you. We're the generation that's supposed to know better than this shit. We're the generation that questions shit. And then you got a group of people that impose their will on us because we're our greatest part of divinity on planet Earth. Whether you believe in God, the universe, the ancestors, the greatest thing you've ever been given is the opportunity to ask a question. So much knowledge comes from questions. Oftentimes I learn my most from the questions that's postulated, not the answers that's given. Because we dealing with true intelligence. So when you're smart, you can commit something to memory. But when you're intelligent, the output is several times over that of the input. What do I mean by that? I can tell you 2 plus 2 equals 4. That's the input. But I know the child is brilliant. Not because tomorrow when I ask, what's 2 plus 2 and they say 4? I say, very good, baby girl. No. If my daughter at some point, when I tell her 2 plus 2 equals 4, and she's able to come back to me, and say, well, if 2 plus 2 equals 4, and then 4 minus 2 equals 2, and 2 times 2 equals 4, and then 2 to the second power equals 4. Then I say, hold up, the output tells me you are intelligent. The ability to remember tells me that you are smart. When the output is several times over that of the input, I know I'm dealing with intelligence. So they want us to walk around here feeling smart, saying shit. Oh, that's conspiracy theory, because you heard other people say that shit. You ain't giving much thought. Now, after you saw that, did you go find out about methodology? Do you study the scholarly method? Do you study Robert's Rules of Conduct? Did you study statistical calculus? Did you find out how to mathematically deduce if something is feigned, if something is false? That's when we know you're intelligent. Not because you say what's popular rumor. Okay? So, CRISPR. Okay? Clustered. Regularly interspaced short palindromic repeat is the way that bacteria defeats the virus. In order for the virus to replicate itself, it needs protein. In order for the bacteria to replicate itself, it needs protein. Bacteria have instructions and they have the tools. Viruses only have the instructions. So they have to get a host cell. And when the virus invades, the bacteria or your cells. When it invades the bacteria, it uses the tools of that which is using as a host. So it can replicate itself. And in this particular instance, it would be called lysogeny. And then the bacteria would explode, and the viruses would now go out and deploy into the community. This could be the community inside of the body, wherever they may be, wherever the bacteria and the viruses may have met. It deploys in the community to do the same thing over and over. But if the bacteria doesn't realize it's getting instructions from a foreign invader, it will follow the instructions and destroy itself. And that's what human beings are doing. You don't realize the instructions you get to protect yourselves is coming from people that tend to colonize you, invade you. So in turn, you destroy yourselves through speculations amongst each other, and you think he's up to something, she think he's up to something, but those instructions come from the colonizer. And in a microcosmic scale, the same thing happens. Viruses behave as agents and change the data. That's what they do. I'm just doing my thing to make sure I can make the proper analogy so you can feel what I'm saying. So the viruses go in there, and if the bacteria doesn't have a debriefing or intel about who this is, oh, this is our people. It does the bidding, and these instructions cause the bacteria to be destroyed within itself. It dies, and then, like I said, the viruses deploy to replicate themselves and do the rest of the community. The whole community dies. Takeover is inevitable. Virus come in there, rewrite the script, and say, this is now your new mission. And you start following the mission, the new curriculum. But every so often, a bacteria survives. And it lives to give an account of what took place. Every so often, there's an activist. And the activist survives and it tells his progeny. The activist survives and it tells his progeny. It tells his children. It tells the community. It debriefs everyone about the enemy when the enemy shows up. And when the enemy arrives, everyone's ready the next time. Because they don't say, bacteria doesn't say, oh, that's conspiracy theory. We heard about that virus shit you talking about. No one really dies from the viruses. Bacteria don't do that. They say, oh, word? That's how they got the drop on us? That's how our community got destroyed? You just gotta move on one leg. I'm telling you, I'm gonna warn you, this is how the enemy looks, talks, acts, thinks, and dress. Some of that shit sound like us, but if you really catch them in between, you'll realize it ain't you. Oh, word? Okay, so we gonna let the virus come again and think he got the drop on us, but this time we'll be ready for him. And that's called CRISPR. That's what that is. Why do we need to know all of this information? I'm gonna tell you why. Because you're eliminating all the good bacteria in your body, and by reducing the count of bacteria in your body, this is less than likely to occur, because the bacteria that's constantly going to war with viruses will fuck around and kill the virus for you. But you're destroying the good bacteria in your body with the antibacterial soaps and with the antibiotics, because you know what antibiotics do? Antibiotics say, yo, first of all, antibiotics are not used to kill viruses, because viruses are not dead or alive. You got to deal with viruses differently. Bacteria alive, viruses are not dead and they're not alive. This scientific study. They don't meet the qualifications. Viruses are created to change information and replicate that information. We would call on this human scale propaganda. Okay? Viruses control the media and have the whole body doing some old new shit. That's what viruses do. This is really us on a microscopic level. Antagonists and protagonists. Okay? The virus is the antagonist, the bacteria in this particular instance is the protagonist, but understand that the reason why there's good bacteria is not because the bacteria is really rooting for humans. The bacteria does things in its best interest, the good bacteria, that inadvertently affect us the best way. That's why we qualify as good bacteria, not that the bacteria has an agenda to take care of us either. Like, we are using the planet Earth as a host, and we don't normally do things in the best interest of planet Earth, but when we start getting healthy, we start thinking about protecting ourselves, we inadvertently do good by the planet Earth. When we want to eat better, we inadvertently do better by planet Earth. It's just how it works. So we're using planet Earth as a host, and we're behaving like parasites as human beings on another scale as well. But that is for another conversation. So, antibiotics, kills bacteria. It does not eliminate viruses. Antibiotics eliminate bacteria. You take antibiotics to destroy a virus, and you'll destroy good and bad bacteria, because antibiotics works like this. Hey, there's a city here, and it's enemies in the city. We can't tell the enemies from the patrons or the supporters, because the enemies are hiding in places that we can't find them. We're tired of looking for the enemies. So what we'll do is just destroy the whole damn city with the good and the bad people. That's where antibiotics are. We will eliminate the bad bacteria, the infectious bacteria. And the way we're going to do that is by destroying the whole community. Because damn it, even though the good will go, the bad will go with them. So the question is, who arises next? Well, you bred the colony of bad bacteria several times over every single day, because the bad bacteria thrive off of white flour, white sugar, all sorts of, just too much sugar in general, you know, dairy, eggs, milk, cheese, right? So the bad bacteria thrive off of that. You breed colonies of bad bacteria every day. There's a war every day with good and bad bacteria, and there's a war with bacteria and viruses. And we are working against ourselves, because the way we eat and the things that we use. So antibiotics, again, kills good and bad bacteria, because we don't know how to differentiate between the good and the bad. We get lazy. We don't know how to find the bad ones amongst the good ones. Kill the good and the bad ones. That's what antibiotics do. So what they should tell you is, you need to replace the good bacteria, because you replace the bad every time you eat the bullshit. There's plenty of bullshit available every single day. But how do you replace the good bacteria? Because you want to, during these times, if you're worried about flu season, because that's what this is all about at the end of the day. If you're worried about bad if you're worried about viruses, and we know bacteria fights viruses, they do fight each other. And taking an antibiotic to eliminate viruses is taking something to eliminate bacteria. And the bacteria actually, good bacteria can actually eliminate viruses by taking data about them. So your body kind of works and creates a form of a vaccine inadvertently when the bacteria that exists in your body says we're not letting them stay here because he's fucking up our space and our environment. And that's what makes them good to us on another level. But it's not that they're being good because they want to keep you, the human, alive per se. It's because it creates conditions conducive for them, and inadvertently it's conducive for us. Just to make that clear, there's no agenda to keep you alive. These organisms thrive in you every day, and they think about self-preservation as a community. Okay? And so, over here, the antibacterial soaps, wiping down your whole house, wipe down your walls, wipe down the banisters 6-7 times a day. Make sure that you use these hand sanitizers. All you're doing is killing the good bacteria 6-7 times a day. You're doing it way more than you normally would. Most of you don't wash your hands any goddamn way. Okay? And I can tell you why I know this. Because there's people walking around, no, you have to start covering your mouth, all right? You have to start covering your mouth and wash your hands several times. Fam, you wasn't washing your hands and covering your mouth prior? Oh yeah, y'all gonna die. Humanity's falling. You see, a lot of these people are out because you can't microwave good behavior overnight. You can't turn around and say, oh man, it's time to start leading a healthy life. You can't skip everything and just think you wash your hands and you save. It don't work like that. It just doesn't work like that. You can't now, oh, because you know what you're going to do? You're going to overcompensate. So you wash your hands too damn much. You're getting rid of too much good bacteria. You're wiping down the halls and the house and everything. People spraying the floor with the good bacteria and thinking they're getting a drop on it. They're cleaning every damn thing. They're getting rid of all the good guys that would eliminate a virus. This is called your microbiome, your gut. Your gut is connected to your brain. There's a synapse that connects the gut to the brain. It's called enteroendocrine cells. Enteroendocrine cells exist in the synapse, which means it connects a bridge. That bridge between the gut and the brain is called the vagus nervous system. That vagus nervous system also connects your heart to your brain. The real brains in your body are the heart and the gut. The brain that gets the credit for being the brain is really a master linguist. The brain speaks the language of all the heart cells, the foot cells, you know, the stomach cells, and is able to say, I'm going to deploy some neurotransmitters to the rest of the body because I understand what you need. But when something compromises the integrity of the communication, that's when the body starts to have a malfunction. So the brain is the multilingual element of the human body. It can speak the language of all the other parts of the body. It waits for a message so long as it isn't compromised. Because remember, viruses come in there and change the messages and make you do their bit to destroy yourself. Cancer is very similar. That's why cancer and viruses sometimes look alike. We went over that. Because cancers would create a new situation for you to fight yourself. And then now you got something called what? Autoimmune diseases. Sounds similar all over again. They call diabetes an autoimmune disease. Where the cells are kind of like, we're not going to do that, we're going to do this. But you don't realize after years of feeding your children cow's milk, there's a lot of things that go wrong with that. Before we close this part out, this is what I need the Facebook vibe for. Cow's milk is high in sulfur-containing amino acids. The sulfur in high amounts, sulfur's not bad, but sulfur-containing amino acids coming from animal's milk causes the pH of the body to be thrown off. The pH is like the temperature. So it's okay to have an acidic pH for the stomach, but it's not okay to have an acidic pH when we're talking about other places in the human body. So when you take a sulfur-containing amino acids, what the body does is say, oh shit, you're changing our pH. Picture you being in a warehouse that's freezing cold, and they're not giving you a heater. It's gonna be hard for you to do the things you have to do in the warehouse because your fingers is freezing. Picture you being in a warehouse that's hot as hell on a 100 plus degree day, and there's no air conditioning. It's gonna be hard to do your work. Well, you have sugars, you have enzymes that's created to break down the sugars. Just because you need the right amount of amino acids that group together, become proteins to create things called enzymes to help break certain things down to your advantage or build things up. So in this case, you have anything with an OSE, most likely is a sugar, and anything with an ASE, most likely is a protein. So you have lactose and you have lactase. Lactose being a sugar is a disaccharide, so it's made up of two different sugars. Boom, two big molecules, that's huge. Not one molecule, but two. So it's very hard to break down lactose. And so you have lactase, which is designed to break down lactose. Lactase is the enzyme. So think about it like Pac-Man. So Pac-Man looks like this, right? He's going around eating the pellets. But think about the other thing that Pac-Man eats is shaped alternatively to that which is the shape of Pac-Man. Which means this would be the molecule, this is the ACE, and this is the enzyme with the, this is the OSE. Okay, this is the ACE, this is the enzyme, ACE, lactase, and this is the OSE. And this should be shaped like this. Only thing should be two servings because it's a disaccharide. The lactose is a disaccharide. So what happens is when the temperature is not right, the enzyme gets messed up at the part that's equal to the part that does the breaking down. This would be called the what? The substrate. The substrate is the part of the enzyme that fits snug with the part of the sugar that is supposed to break down. Wow. But when the pH of the body is contorted or is too low, the enzymes that are supposed to break down, in this particular case, lactose, the lactase at the substrate area becomes disfigured. And now it's not shaped properly to break down the lactose properly. And so now they say you're lactose intolerant. You feel what I'm saying? Because the pH is off. Because where you're getting your source of milk is changing the temperature, and the temperature is disfiguring the enzyme at the substrate area where it has to demolish the molecule. And not only can it not demolish the molecule, it's a double serving molecule because it's a disaccharide, meaning two sugars in one. Furthermore, your body's not supposed to be taking in that milk for the rest of your life because you go through puberty and you have hormones, and hormones are instructions. So you have instructions that it take you from here to 12 to 13, and instructions that it take you into adulthood, and even instructions that take you from adulthood into middle age. Hormones are instructions. So when you take in cow's milk, you take in cow's blood, this is fact, And the Milk is allowed to have 750,000 somatic cells, a euphemism for pus, and it's allowed to have 24,000 live bacteria before the Food and Drug Administration takes it off the shelf and is allowed to be pasteurized, the process in which they use radiation to prolong the shelf life of that product. Radiation that causes cancer. But let's ignore all of that. And let's go to this part real quick. The milk is high in sulfur-containing amino acids. It changes the pH of the body. What the body does as a first line of defense is said we have to buffer the acidity by using calcium to get the pH right. It has to find calcium from somewhere. The body says, let's leach. That's the process. Let's take calcium from the bones. When we need something, we can go to the bones and pull the damn calcium. This is what your body does if you don't get the sufficient amount of calcium. In order to get the sufficient amount of calcium, they say milk does the body good. Yeah, cow's milk is high in calcium, very low in magnesium. So guess what's going to happen? You can't take calcium without enough magnesium because then the calcium becomes toxic. So magnesium helps you absorb calcium. But they want you to take a cup of calcium with no magnesium. So anyway, and on top of it, your source of milk is high in sulfur-containing amino acids, which turns the pH to acidic as opposed to a pH of 7 or more. pH means potential hydrogen. So your body has to go through a process to try to get you back into the 7 plus range of pH, and it goes through a leaching process where it pulls calcium from off your bones. Just the buffer, the acidity, so it can do its job, so that the substrate of the enzyme is not disfigured, so it won't have a problem breaking down a double molecule of sugar called the disaccharide. But now there's excess calcium in your bloodstream, and those deposits have to be allocated into the liver. And now you can wind up with all sorts of problems, which one of them becomes diabetes. That's another conversation for another day. But where's the instructions? Hormones are instructions. Diabetes is a hormonal disorder because you have a problem producing insulin. Insulin is a hormone. Hormones give instructions. Insulin gives the body instructions for the cells to open up their walls to allow blood sugar in the form of glucose to go in so the cells can metabolize, meaning to do whatever work that they specialize in. So where's the issue here? You're taking cow's milk, you're taking cow hormones, you're taking cow instructions. For a baby cow that's 65 pounds to one day grow into a 400-pound cow. You feed your child cow's milk, they're getting instructions to become a 400-pound cow. You know what I'm saying? This shit is real. So what happens is, we say, oh, child obesity, yo, I have a genetic predisposition to being fat. My nigga, you've been taking cow's instructions to become fat. It's not a genetic predisposition. Ignorance is a genetic predisposition. It's passed on from one culture to the next until the younger people break the chain and say, Mom, I love you, but you're the only one who can get away with poisoning me. It has to stop today. It's very hard because your emotions is linked to the food because your parents cook the food that you like for certain events when you do good on your grades, when you pass your tests, when you win awards, when you get trophies, they cook you shit. In some cases, literally, shit. Chitlins. Intestines, they cook you this and it'll taste delicious. They cook up the blood. I know how y'all do in the Spanish world. You be cooking up that blood, it be delicious. I ate a lot of that, I loved it. I come from it, I tell you to this day, it was delicious. Never gonna lie to you. It tasted like it was good, but it was bad. Cause good food don't taste bad and bad food tastes good. That's a psychological problem that they do to us. Good food can't taste bad. I don't like good food because it tastes bad. I like bad food because it tastes bad. No, that's how bad it tastes. You gotta reprogram yourself. If it's bad food, that's how bad it tastes. If it's good food, that's how good it tastes. How the hell are you gonna tell me the good food tastes bad? Bad food? You sound like the damn devil. You make me believe in the devil. That sounds like some devil meant right there. If the food is bad, that's how bad it tastes. And if you love how bad it tastes, you gotta be reprogrammed. If the food is good and you tell yourself and you know scientifically, mathematically, foods, how do you think I know all this information? I had to seduce myself with facts to accept it. Man, this is how good tastes. Because I was like, man, this good tastes bad and bad tastes good. I was doing that shit. I had to keep studying until I finally brainwashed myself. Good tastes good, bad tastes bad. Say it with me again, but like, I had to introspect and talk to myself. I finally got convinced good tastes good because it's good. That's how good must taste because it's good. And then eventually, bad started actually tasting bad. Because I recognized when I taste that taste, this is what it'll probably do. It brings me back to when my grandmother died of dementia, when my mother died of cancer. My father had to blow his nose out of his throat. It starts bringing me back because I was raised on the curry goat of my grandfather. And on the pig feet, the pig ears, and the pigtail that was boiled in the rice to make the rice taste salty for my grandmother. And the oxtail of rice every Sunday. And the fish on Fridays because we believe in Christ, whatever that means. You know what I'm saying? This is true. We grew up like this. And I'm emotionally still connected to it. If I think about some of these foods right now, there's an old part of my psychology that's tempted to go back to oxtail and rice and peas and smoked neck bones and lima beans with pigtail. I love that. And it was, stick to the gut, boy. Eat it. Whatever that means. My poppy's blood, all that, the oatmeal and everything, stick to your gut, boy. Oh, it's cold outside. You need to get your smoked neck bone and your lima beans. What the hell was he talking about? You know what I'm saying? I don't know. My pop thought he was telling me the right shit. They all thought so. Because that's the programming. We raised on it, so it's right. But one day, we got to come to terms and say, we got to gradually make change. Gradually make change. You don't got to go cold turkey overnight. Do one thing at a time. Because eventually, the knowledge will take you over because you exist in truth. Because before you lie, you have to hesitate. Fact. But when you tell the truth, you can be straight up. That's never changed from the day you was born. As a child, you had to lie to get out of trouble, and you revealed everything before your parents. When you knew the lie would get you to escape, but you took too damn long to tell the lie because it's proof. There's a mechanism in you where you cannot lie first. You're designed to tell the truth first. You're designed. The upper left hand, your eye goes in the upper left hand corner, you're lying. Because that's the imagery construction area. Because whatever you're looking at, you're accessing the opposite side of your brain. So imagery and construction is at the bottom right side of your brain. So when your eyes look up this way, you're accessing this part of your brain. If you look down, you're remembering how something smells. We are wired to tell the truth whether you like it or not. These are facts. If I asked you about what you was doing today and you start going to the upper left-hand corner, you're going to the imagery construction area that's right here, because the right side of your brain deals with images. And manipulation, and emotion, and love, and art, and music, and the left side of your brain deals with math, science, language, and reading. So once you go this way, your eyes are connected to your brain. So wherever your eyes go, equal and opposite to it, is the part of your brain that you're accessing. Your sense of memory of smell is up here. So you gotta look down to remember how something smells. So if you catch a person, how does a banana smell? Guaranteed, eyes goes down. Because their eyes are connected to their brain, they're accessing up. That's how this shit is, we're wired. I know I'm a weirdo because I take the time out. I never took time out to try to learn any of this. I come across it in the middle of whatever I'm doing, and then I get fixed for the shit. Like, reading and writing is what I do for a living. It is my video game. Some people get paid to play video games in this era. I get paid to play my video games, reading and writing, because I never want to not know again, because I never want to be in front of my grandmother and can't do something. I never want my children to be in front of their grandmother and can't do something. I never want to be in front of my wives and children and I feel helpless like I did when I watched my mama die, when I watched my grandfather die, when I watched my grandmother die, and when I watched my aunt die of cancer. I couldn't do nothing for them because I was ignorant. I didn't even have a solution. I didn't have a suggestion. The only thing I could do is say, those people got the plaques hung up there. They know more than me. What could I do? My life was at their disposal. Completely ignorant. Didn't know where to go, where to start, just to see if I could verify, substantiate, or properly corroborate the testimony of the damn doctor so I could feel confident and have the conviction that they're doing the right thing. But instead, I had to be there holding my mama's hand. Meeting her for the first time. Only had 7 days before I had to hold her hand. And we just had to hope and pray that this works out. Because we didn't have enough knowledge to know they was bullshitting us. So when people ask, do I have credentials to share truth? When the hell did we need credentials to share facts? You really need someone to tell you what a fact is a fact because they have a paper standing behind them? When the damn institution that they represent takes you to the pharmacy amongst all words, which means sorcery or witchcraft out of all words, and you think this is a trick, you think this is semantics, where the right aid is ritual in front of your face, but you think he's semantic, just like you probably think television is just not tell lies on your vision, but polite playing with words. But then they got programs to program you, but that's probably a semantic too, right? And they channel into your mind, well, I got a better one. Mortgage. Pledge your agreement till you die. Mort means death, like a mortuary. And then gage, pledge your agreement. Pledge your agreement till you die. But mortgage, hypothecation. Hypothecation means to dig a hole and to bury. Foreclose means to cast away a spirit. But these is all, I'm just making this shit up. I'm making this all up. You can look up these words etymologically and see that when you, what is it? You get buried in debt. And when you hang up all your pictures, you got all your trophies, because I went through it. I had trophies taller than me, and I was always tall as a young man. And when we had to give up our home and I had to be homeless, I had to leave everything that I put my fucking spirit into that house that got foreclosed. And my grandmother lost her mind when she lost her house after she worked for 9X, and she had that house for as long as she worked for 9X, over 30 years, damn near 40. And when she had lost her house, she lost her mind the year after. She died in the nursing home the year after that shit. And her best memories, whenever she would recollect anything when she had dementia, was always in that damn house. Over and over, the same memory of her getting the house and being able to allow her family to live in it. And when she found out her grandchildren and her children no longer could live in her house, she lost her goddamn mind when she lost her house. She lost her spirit. She lost her breath, her last breath. Spirit means breath. I don't make this shit up. So when they foreclose, they kill your spirit. Because you put everything in that fucking house because you're there believing you're going to keep that for the rest of your life and pass it on to your children. So they kill your spirit and they bury you in debt. And they make you pledge an agreement that you're going to be in debt until you die. Mortgage, mortgage, hypothecation, foreclosure. I don't play with these words. And I'll be damned if I let an ignorant mother effer tell me I'm making up shit when I know I read. And I study and I verify. How the hell can you go against undisputable facts? You can look it up yourself. So when we out here bending on this beast for real, not giving you all that black power rhetoric and put your feet on the devil's neck, we not doing that. We out here talking about, you know what? We gonna save your home, brother. And this shit is over people's heads. Because you don't see that. You want to hear me talk that rhetoric shit about an all-black planet and put our boots on this cracker's neck. You want me to come out with all-black outfits with cargo and looking like I got grenades in my vest and shit and berets and step in here with black boots like people are doing. You want me doing that bullshit. But when I'm talking to you about that real, when I'm talking to you about the stock market, when I'm talking to you about borrowing against insurance policies, and open up an irrevocable life insurance trust. See, when I'm talking that, I'm talking like the white man to y'all. But I'm really talking to you like a revolutionary, and I'm talking to you like you're intelligent enough to make better decisions as adults. Because I wasn't raised in those decisions because our parents didn't know enough, but they knew enough to get us to this point. But I'll be damned if I die with the same amount of information that my predecessors had when they gave birth to me. We're supposed to be the better version of our mothers and fathers. Not the same or worse. They did what they can do, granted the circumstances, because I do recall that my mother's mother was taught by a slave straight off the damn plantation. It wasn't too long ago. 400 plus years of servitude, 70, 80 years of freedom. We all want to be messed up, but some of us are like this bacteriophage that wakes the hell up, or they thought was dead, and got up and survived, and realized, yo, I'm gonna spread the word. And if the damn bacteria community treated the rest of the bacteria, the woke bacteria, like y'all treat y'all own when someone got the knowledge, we would have never made it this far because we'd have been eliminated biologically. They got this shit right on this biological level. We got to get it right on this level. So you see these programs and you say, yo, why we got to pay for this? Why? Because you'll never have to pay again in your life. You never ask them student loan mother efforts for a refund when they lied to you. And now they got you in debt, $20,000, $30,000, $40,000, $50,000 and up. And you ain't got a job that come remotely close to help you pay it in this lifetime or two. But when we come and I say, yo, it's $3,000, I say it with pride and conviction. Because I know goddamn well that it's going to change your life. You ain't never going to be in debt again unless you make the same mistake again. And even if you do, you wouldn't be able to make it twice. It's almost impossible because we educate you in the interim of the process. You have to be a bona fide idiot for us to clean up all your credit, get you access to six figures for you to live and do it again twice. Use a crackhead at that point. You got a gambling problem, addiction problem. You mess around with too much prostitutes. Something's going on. And even if you got those kind of problems, we still teach you how to allocate your funds so you can kill yourself happy. You'll kill yourself in an overdose, but not because you can't afford the drugs the next time around. You'll kill yourself if you got a sexually transmitted disease because they before all prostitutes this time around. What I'm saying is whether you do it the right way or you do it the wrong way, it's still going to be the right way under your criteria, because we ain't going to have you being broke by someone else's standard or conditions. Because like I told you, you got a 9-to-5, that's 8 hours you go to work, 8 hours you're working. It probably take you an hour to go to work, it probably take you an hour to come back from work. That's 10 hours. Then you're supposed to sleep 8 hours, the average person sleeps about 6 hours, that's 18, that's 16 hours. That leaves what? Let's think about it. If 16 hours left, you go to work, 9-to-5 is 8 hours. To go to work is about an hour. To come back home from work is about an hour. So now we got 9-to-5, 8 hours, 1 hour, 1 hour, going to the fro, 10. You sleep about 6 hours, the 16 hours, you got 8 hours left. So 2/3 of your life is devoted to building someone else's dream. All I ever try to tell you is, pardon the word trial, all I ever did was tell you, you shouldn't be in the 1/3. 1/3 of your time should be towards work and service. And the 2/3 should be towards you. Because with that 1/3 you got left, you're supposed to socialize. Maybe parent if you're a parent. Cook, hopefully you cook. Clean, hopefully you clean. And you need time to meditate, pray, introspect, travel, study. But you know what you're going to sacrifice with the 1/3 of time that's left in that 24-hour cycle? You're going to sacrifice reading, studying, meditating, all the things that make you who you really are. Because if you don't exist in your head most of the time of your day, you don't exist at all. If you are this physical body most of your time, you don't even exist. That's a fact. If you're not reading, if you're not studying, yo, the human body is made up of little more than 600 muscles. The two things on the planet that requires that you use most, at least half the muscles, the most muscles, is what? The human body is made up of about 600 plus muscles. And you don't use more muscles for anything else you do than to do what two things? Read or meditate. It requires more muscle energy. You use over 300 muscles to read or to meditate, to stay still. And if you think I'm lying, if you know you're not reading like you're supposed to, if you know you're not studying like you're supposed to, if you know someone's not reading or studying like they're supposed to, ask them to sit still. Ask them to go in a meditation position and do nothing and silence their thoughts. Don't think of nothing coming in, don't think of nothing. Watch the confusion. You will see an exorcism. You will see people like, you'll see them. They can't stay still. I guarantee you. It takes more muscle energy to stay there concentrating on a specific thing at a time than it does to do any of your three favorite exercises that require muscle. These are scientific facts. So if you're not reading, you're not studying, you're not doing mental calisthenics, it's no wonder. So when people combat me, don't mistake my aggression and my conviction for anger. Because I will never get mad at a person that's sick. Because when people fight against me, I understand what it is. Because I know what I'm dealing with. I know what I'm dealing with. And we ain't never say, that person got cancer, kick their ass. That person got diabetes, we should put him in a headlock and stomp his ass out. We never did that. So what if someone has cancer of the mind? What if someone has diabetes of the mind? Because mental health is real. But the problem with mental health, it doesn't register as a bump. It doesn't register as a tumor. We don't see it. So when I know I'm talking to people that's mentally ill, I don't wish them harm. I think of disease. And I know that, one, it can be contagious. You can be so mentally ill, you make me want to be as crazy as you and turn up and get violent. So I know that mental illness can be contagious. I also know that with disease, it can be treated. But the person has to want to get the treatment. And a treatment isn't a cure. It's just a road to a better disposition. And then ultimately is a cure. But there ain't no helping no one if they're not willing to help themselves. So just like any other disease, when I know the mentally ill is speaking to me, combating me, fighting me for things they shouldn't be fighting for, I never get angry with them because I understand. Like, we shouldn't be beaten or badgered. My grandmother used to do this to me. I go outside without a jacket. I get sick the next day. You know what she does? I'm like, Grandma, I'm sick. You want to make me tea? She got to give me a damn lecture and annoy me. I told you don't go out there without a jacket. I got to hear all this before I get my soup and my tea. Rubbing it all in my face. It felt bad to be sick and someone to rub it in my face. That's what I'm not going to do to my people. ain't gonna rub it in your face. I'm gonna smile with you. And I'm gonna act like you making sense while you fighting me. While you troll me, I'm gonna smile. And I'm gonna act like I'm not living a better life than you. And all I wanted to do was share my experience. I may not have the best life, but I'm content in my situation. And I would like to be, I would like to have neighbors just as content doing as I do, like I do. Not necessarily the same thing, but in the same space mentally. I would love for one day for me to come out and 3, 4, 5 people that we helped get their home, got them out of debt, got them the loans, set up their companies to set up wealth stewardship, generational wealth that you pass down from one generation to the next. It's called stewardship. Wealth stewardship. I would love to be in a community of people like that, because now we become the shakers and movers. And if we had to pool our funds, I would love to create the opportunity for all of you to get access to 6 figures. Because no one will cry we broke when it's time to do something powerful for the community. What's a $5,000 or $10,000 when I'm up 6 figures I never had? See, so my goal has been, if I want to get money from my people, why not me learn how to help them get to the money? A person who helped get to the money is not going to have a problem putting something up, pooling the fund. As well, a person who has little to nothing. That doesn't mean everything's free. But what it does mean is whatever you can do, it's going to take you that much more further. But are you willing to roll the dice on yourself? Because the fear element always comes in. I hope this isn't right. I can't afford to lose nothing. And that's what's killing us all the time. We don't have enough money to even be in a conversation. That's why wealth is stipulated per the Standard & Poor's S&P index, that wealth begins at $150,000 a year. Granted, you don't contradict the 50-30-20 principle. The 50 is obligation. The 30 is recreational things. And then the 20 is investment in debt that's accumulated for the purposes of being able to be leveraged for credit. It's 50, 30, 20. 50% mandatory, like light, gas, all the other utilities, mortgage, car note, whatever. 30% for my sanity. I can't just be making money and doing nothing with myself. I need to make money and sometimes go get something nice to eat. Something that's not mandatory. 30% is supposed to be for sanity. And then 20% is for debt and investments or savings. But in my world, savings and investment runs concurrent. It's the same word. I changed my definition. Because if I don't plan to spend certain money, I don't leave it in the bank idly. I create my own annuity, or I put it in recurring investments or things that give me a recurring return. If I don't plan to touch the money I'm saving, I put it somewhere where, as an expenditure, I can get it back long term, because I got patient money to do that. But when you leave money there idly, all you're gonna do is access it when the time comes, like now. Now we're panic shopping and buying 20 rolls of paper. I would rather wipe my ass with my hand before I spend my last dollars on toilet paper, when I can get a different type of paper at my disposal for investing in some stocks that are presently the price of the fucking toilet paper. There'd be no harm in me just having. Now it makes sense to get some hand sanitizer and wipe my 7-8 times a day. Now it makes sense to do it. Because the times I gotta use the bathroom with all this alkaline food I'm consuming. I would rather do that. So that's what these courses are for. When I do the master course, when I do the entrepreneur course, or when we do the credit restoration micro, you don't realize right now if you were prepared, you'd be able to purchase a house and then access the equity inside of 5-7 damn days. You probably don't even understand what that means and represents. You fix your credit during this time. The market is available to you for as long as the coronavirus exists. I don't want to sound insensitive. I just want to break this stuff down so you understand why I'm without worry. So I can focus on making this money during this hour. I want to void you guys of worry about the wrong thing. Because I can guarantee you, people in better positions than you give a hell about this virus more than they give a hell about their finances. People are losing money because they ain't had the right investment vehicles, and now that the stock market is plummeted, they lost money through their 401ks. Their Social Security is at risk. Dire straits. This is what responsible adults are thinking about. And then you have us stocking up on tissue galore. Somebody gotta stop this shit in our community. And if I catch your ass one more time, I might bitch smack you if I see one of us in the store again buying some damn tissue again. I might have to go crazy if I see it. And I'll go live too, because you know I'm wild enough to pull this shit. I'm about to bark on somebody if I see them loading up on tissue and I ask them some questions about gold or silver stock. I told y'all what app to download, Kitco. Silver, I told you, if you ever see it, neighboring $8 to $14. I told you this, you can look at my previous streams. Buy it ASAP. Because that's about as low as you ever want to see silver. Silver was just around $35 to $42 before all this chaos. Fluctuating. So picture you buying something at $12, which it is right now on Kitco. When this market gets right and people start realizing, okay, things are getting better, what you think is going to happen? Platinum right now is almost three times cheaper than it was. It's at $648 or something like that right now. When silver goes back up to about $40, 12, 24, 36, if you bought it at $12, oh, your money going triple. You should be buying 10 ounces of silver every single day if you can afford it. $120 every day is what I'm doing. Every day. Every day. Every day. Because that shit is going to go up. It's going to go up. And I ain't cashing out until it's triple or more. And then you have major fluctuations that take place. And let's not even talk about Ethereum. That when it's low, it's $90 less than a week ago. That has been as high as over 350 at one point in time. It's going to go back up. But if you spend all your money on tissue and killing the good bacteria, what good does it make? So I got to stop you from killing the good bacteria and killing your chances to come out of this shit with the gold at the end of the rainbow of the crisis. That's what this is about. Go to the next slide. We almost out of here. And see, I can't do this on Instagram. I ran out of time on top of them. I ran out of time. You know, I miss being in the lecture form, but we can't have more than 50 people congregate. I gotta be here and feel the spirit of thousands of people, but guess what? I'm gonna talk like I feel the thousands of you paying attention, so I know my words are not going in vain. And if it wasn't love, I'd get straight to the money talk and get up out of here if it wasn't the love. If you're gonna tell me you can't take from what you was given, boom, get rid of it. Stop this. Don't get stuff that has triclosan in it. Triclosan in it, and don't get anything that says antibacterial. We can do better than that. And I'm going to do a lecture on some products that's good. I don't like promoting products that I don't benefit from immediately, but these are one of them circumstances where I'm going to have to do it. I don't deal with that. They need to come up with some revenue, because when we all go out there and buy that compliments of Brother Polite, or you ain't getting no bread. So I don't really like doing this, but I got to do it because of the crisis we're in. And you got anything but the toilet paper in the damn house. We can't do it. Let's go to the next one. Antibiotics. Let's go. Well, you know what? Leave it right there, because I don't want to go to the other side. But I wanted to show you this to close out, to give you an idea of what we're talking about. I don't know if you can, you can probably put the light to it. But these are some Acidophilus, or you have Lactobacillus, which is the same good bacteria. This is coconut kefir. They didn't have the one that has no flavor. I just like the coconut flavor. I don't trust what kind of sweetness people use. I don't like the berry flavor stuff. I'm not down with none of that. I just want it the way it is. If I want berries, I'll eat some berries and then I'll drink the liquid that I bought. That's how I do berry flavor. I don't need nobody doing berry flavor for me. You know what I'm saying? I'm not with it, but I had to do this. This one is coconut water, probiotic coconut water. Here they go with the blueberry, blackberry sparkling. See, I don't like all that energy, but I had to get it because it was just that type of crisis. But generally, these things are going to be right on the shelves. The tissue is missing. The probiotics are there, people. Get your probiotics. You feel me? This is not the most appealing taste. But for me, good tastes good. And when good is needed in a crisis, it tastes great. So, you know my motto, this is delicious. You know what I'm saying? But when you first take that spoon, remember you're programmed. So don't say Polite is lying to me. Say that I'm programmed. Don't say I'm lying to you.
Look, show the other one.
Oh, yeah, my bad.
Bio-K.
Bio-K.
No, you got it in the fridge.
Oh, put it by the light. Oh, I'm going to bring it out. Damn, I forgot about that. So this is the coconut kefir. This is fermented. Basically, it's fermented goods.
When fermented coconut water.
Fermented coconut water. When you are taking probiotics, When you take a prebiotic, an example of a prebiotic would be inulin, which is a non-digestible fiber. And you might say, so why do we want to take fiber that the body can't digest? It's just like you want to take starch that the body can't digest regularly, which is called resistant starch. What happens is the non-digestible fiber that you might get out of an avocado or some asparagus, it goes into the small intestines, and then it has to sit there because it can't be digested, and then the small intestines, it gets fermented in there. And then the probiotics, which are the good bacteria, can eat that. All right, so we gotta go through a class of what constitutes a prebiotic, which is the food that the probiotics eat. So once you replace the good bacteria in your body that have been eliminated from all the antibacterial soaps and all the antibiotics, and plus the lack of just even consuming food that has good bacteria in it, you also have to feed them. Otherwise, they'll lose the war against the good bacteria that's constantly being fed through all the white sugar, white flour, white salt, white potato, so forth and so on. If it's white, probably ain't white.
They ask where you can get it from.
Whole Foods. I'm not a fan of this. Air One, if you're in LA, you go to LA. Air One is the best. But hold on. I'm about to give you some. Where is this? You know what? You go ahead. You can pull it out. We gonna get you there. I want to thank you guys for staying up with me this late. For those of you that's on the East Coast. That's interesting. Oh, for those of you that's on the East Coast. Go ahead. This is good. This is fermented hemp and peas. Fermented pea and hemp probiotic. This is like our yogurt. This is our form of yogurt. Okay, so when it's fermented, that means good bacteria is created in the aftermath, and we consume this.
It's gluten-free.
It's gluten-free.
Organic.
That's right.
And vegan.
And it's vegan. It's gluten-free, organic, and vegan. Okay, and it's pea and hemp.
And it's soy, dairy, and grain-free.
You want all these, coconut, soy, dairy, and grain-free. You see all of that? You see what's going on here? This ain't no game. And we're gonna do a whole presentation on the breakdown of the foods and why when the time comes. Tribe Called Quest, y'all, come on, what y'all know about that? What you know about this man right here? What you know about that? Come on, man, let's stay focused. ADHD is big in the community too. We gotta get rid of that. I think, they said I had it. They said I had it, so hey, I turned out just right. I couldn't focus. I read with like 5-6 books at a time.
Can you switch it back?
Switch it back? Oh, okay. I got you. You just hit this. Yeah, so hey, moral of the story, they said I had ADHD. I was put into the slow class. I celebrated beyond them. Had to put up fights for being too smart. They put me back in the honors class. I went on one heck of a journey because I always wanted to sit by the window. If I couldn't sit by the window, I was in silent protest walking around the class. And my pops, as much as he would beat me, it just wasn't working. He had to go to the teachers and beg them, please. I guarantee you the work would be good if you could just sit by the window.
Asking about the app to buy the precious metals.
The app to buy the precious metals. I got a presentation coming up. Right now you can download KITCO. KITCO. It's just saying gold live. It's black and gold. So I'll tell you that. I'm going to do a presentation to show you how that works. You also should get a Precious Metals Refinery account. I'll give you the name of the refinery account for the presentation. I make nothing from these people. This is just love I'm giving to you. That's all it is. You need to get down with it. If you wait 48 hours, I also have a book being released. The reason why I'm releasing the books, I miss writing. That's one. Two, I have a phenomenal guy that's just a genius when it comes to credit. I had to collaborate with him out of all humility when it comes to this because I learned a great deal of what I know credit-wise from him. I came to the table with knowledge. I was blown away as he exceeded my expectations from telling me things I did not know. So it's only right to run the information concurrent. This brother's name is John. A lot of you communicate with him when we do the credit restoration microwave. Black Card Bandits, this is what it is. The name of the company. You're gonna see me rocking the hoodie when I do the presentation. It's all love. You know, I'm never ashamed to give sources for material or work. That's what makes you a true scholar. Because I believe people confide in my genius as it is. How much more credit do I need? You feel what I'm saying? Big part of being a genius is also being able to recognize how to be a team member or how to put together a team. That makes you genius. Because if you don't know past yourself, you normally fail. Because in people's quest to be independent, you still depend on somebody for something. And I met an independent black woman who didn't want my help. So what she did, she got a job to get the help from the white man. You see the paradox? I'm an independent woman. I don't want your help. I don't want to rely on my man so I can survive. So you rely on the man so you can survive. Okay. Okay. You're still dependent on somebody, old girl. Just say you want to be independent from dealing with your significant other of the same race and kind. Because I ain't going to work you like the white man do. I want you to have the freedom. I want you to be in the two-thirds, not the one-third. And now look how he do you. Most of you ain't even going to get a check. You got to use that money wisely. Tread it lightly. If I was y'all, the hell before that, I would either get my master course or get my entrepreneur course. I say this proudly with conviction. I'm never ashamed to say spin bread. I'm never ashamed of it. Because that tissue ain't going to turn into no, there ain't going to be no residual income come from that tissue you buy. All that antibacterial soaps ain't going to turn around and give you a specific return on your investment. Not even on your health, because we done broke that down. You guys are good. I'm going to tell you what's going to make you sick. What's going to make you sick is when you barely can walk back to work, but you're crawling. What's going to make you sick is after the first month of this strategy that they're employing, because it only gets worse. This is not no doomsday thing. This is to say, make your money now, while it's going on. I'm not saying wait until the months are over to come into your money. I got a make your money now plan, and make your money after plan, and come into the money when this whole thing is resolved. I will guarantee you, when this whole thing is over, and the markets go up, at the very least, the screenshots that I show you, when I show you what the numbers were, I'm gonna date the video, because I already predicted this last year. No, I'm not a prophet, apostle, messiah. I'm not into all of that. But I gave you a video called The Political Polarization of Global Uncertainty. And I said, the way that the market looks, it is inevitable. Hold off on buying your houses. Hold off on making any major investments. Because when 2020 comes, it is inevitable that the market will fluctuate. Because if you study anything in history, you know every 7 years, the market goes through a major fluctuation. It goes up and it goes down every 7 years. We're 2 years late this time around. If you're studying, the market does this shit. It's called a deterministic algorithm, so you can kind of be able to forecast money. We're not even in that conversation. When those little numbers is going under the screen, when CNN is here, we don't give a damn about that. We don't give a damn about that whole channel. Who cares? And right now things are going on. But they got you buying tissue. I can't shake it enough. Because at the very least, when I buy tissue, I invest in stock. When you buy tissue, you wait in line at the supermarket. The first thing you should have done when it was in China is understand the political polarization of global uncertainty, which is what I talked to y'all about. Cataclysmic events, major speculations of war, actual war, epidemics and pandemics, in some cases outbreaks. Causes the market to shift where you'll be able to forecast it because it drives spending money elsewhere. That's the political polarization of global uncertainty. We're dealing with a political polarization. We're polarizing this experience due to the politics that's persisting with Earth. It's creating a global uncertainty, and global uncertainty messes up the mortgage market and every other commodity, organic or inorganic. It creates a global uncertainty. So we're politically polarized. Hence the term, political polarization of global uncertainty. If some of you may remember that. And when I told people this, oh, don't buy no house, it's silly right now. Stay in an apartment, get a nice condo, don't deal with the maintenance, don't deal with all that stuff. Everything's too high, it's coming in 2020. And I said, I could show you the deterministic algorithms where I can arrive at this conclusion. So first of all, we're a few years overdue, the 7-year interval. And when it goes low, you need to have money available to you. So when shit goes low, you can buy everything up. Buy up Ethereum, buy up silver, buy up platinum. Refinance at a quick level. Forfeit the first money you put in and get the go crazy, go to refi, do everything you can freaking do. Everything must go in this hour, because right now, lenders are looking to just collapse the whole mortgage shit. They please let us stop this shit, because people are benefiting. Please, let's just put this shit on ice. We need a new stimulus package. We need to bail out the banks. We need to do something. But this shit is all rigged. It's all rigged. The virus is real. But it's not really crazy. What's really crazy is you're going for the okey-doke all the time. And if anyone talks to you about money, you grow insecure because you're mad at money. Like money did something to you. Money ain't did nothing to you. From pre-K to 12th grade, you went to school for 14 years. And no one taught you about mortgage, hypothecation, UCC, uniform commercial codes, financing statements, security agreements, purchase agreements, earnest money deposits. No one taught you about insurance. No one taught you about credit, TransUnion, Experian, Equifax, Advantage Score, FICO Score, CDAs, consumer data aggregates. No one taught you about none of these things. But somehow, when you got your diploma, you're supposed to be a functional adult. The only thing you knew how to do was to go into a debt damn near involuntarily. Who did you trust? The two entities you trust in the world are responsible for all your debt. You trust the school system and got your student loan. You trust the bank and you got your damn mortgage. And these are the two people that put you in debt the most. And you asked them to educate you on the spot about the monies they was going to take from you. How about that? Wait until you see this class. Wait till you see it. But I close out so I don't digress. I digress on purpose and I love it. I love the freedom to do so. That's why they say, yo, like, we need you in the public school system. No, you don't. I get fired. I never stick to the subject. I probably got ADHD and I'm ashamed to say. My mind is all over the place. I can't read one book at a time. I always gotta have 4, 5, 6, 8. Anybody ever catch me reading? The whole table's filled. I need a dictionary there. I need an etymological dictionary there. And I like computers to have my eyes straining on the computer. I still like hard cover books with paper there. I like the organic experience. I want to feel the trees. I don't want to be staring at no damn screen for all those hours. I'm going to put the phone on airplane mode. I like to be organic with this. I like to still highlight stuff and write notes by hand. It's keeping me healthy. That's my vibe. And if I am on a damn computer, it's hell. Because I can't only fit but so much books on the desk, but I can open up Windows galore on the damn computer. So I just need to have books on the desk to keep me safe. So when I have books and a computer open, it's ridiculous. So my mind is everywhere. But the beauty is, I always remember the points that I'm looking for and how to connect the dots. That's why I'm able to connect dots. Because I'd be reading so much things, and I'd be like, hold that thought. Then I open up another window, hold that thought. Then I look into this book, hold that thought. Oh shit, this word means this. But I still hold that, and I don't go to sleep, even if it takes me 10 hours or 12 hours later or 15, until I connect. Now, what was the reason I wanted over here? I gotta reach. Trace my steps. I learned how to keep my point no matter where I'm going. So you never see me on the live stream. Forget what an acronym is. Forget why I said something to connect with something else. Because it's a mental calisthenic. I'm doing mental pull-ups, mental chin-ups, mental dips, mental jumping jacks. That's what I'm doing as I'm jumping into microbial biology, space physics, quantum thermodynamics, whatever the case is. You gotta really fight for your life, family. You can't sit here and just do nothing and hope it gets right. You don't sit here, no more than I tell people, you know, old age doesn't have to be accompanied by arthritis, high blood pressure, and back pain. That's something people accept. No more do you have to accept poverty. You do not have to accept being poor because you're a certain age and you just never learned and you start quitting on yourself. You don't have to accept that. As I speak to you now, I feel you all. That's why I like to get engaged. How much people are you talking to? Okay, where you guys at? Okay, you in Puerto Rico. Okay, several people from Texas, some people in Northern California, Southern California, some people in VA. I like to get a feel so my mind can reach out etherically and connect with my brothers and sisters. I like to know what's at stake. I like to know that I'm not just merely talking through the lens or to the lens of a phone, that I'm actually in thousands of people's households. And if you guys check this live after this, after a few days, you're gonna see I done reached a 250,000. You're gonna see when I reached 1,000,000 people. So I don't play with this because I know people are taking me serious in the masses. And what I'm not about to do is have 1,000,000 people that be able to say, I can prove him wrong that he gave us misinformation. Because it's too much on the line. Because then now they'll strip me of everything that I say, everything thereafter. So before I present to you, I make sure I'm on point. And like I told you, you can fake reading people's hands, reading people's feet. You can fake numerology and astrology to a certain level. You can tell me what woman is good for me to be compatible with, who's going to come into my life. But if you can't turn around and fix your own economical situation, then all that is bullshit. And that's why I separated myself from the community. Because what you can't fake is material success. So that's my barometer. Not that I'm materialistic, I just deal with materialization. I saw the things I wanted that people said I would never get. And now I live in the house they said I would never get, several of them. I'm in Miami. I got my condos out here. I choose when I'm gonna stay out here for extended periods of time, but I live in Beverly Hills. I drive $300,000, $400,000 cars. And I actually can say I have a car collection, I own them all outright. I have a different conversation with people. I pay $1,800 on taxes on one of my cars. But it's a tax shelter. How is that polite? Because you got a car there, $400,000. If I put $400,000 in the bank, if I made $1 million, the IRS would at least $350,000, you know, around. You do notice. Or maybe even 40%. You do notice. So, if I have $400,000, if I put $400,000 in the bank, taxes is probably going to ask me in around $80,000 up. But what if I got a car that's $400,000 and my taxes is $1,800, but my car can be turned in at any given point in time for the type of car that it is? Because it appraises for a certain amount of money and it will only go up from that point. Let's say a 55 Bentley or 35 Benz, my classic cars. Let's just say that while you think I'm a Negro and spending my money on all these fancy cars, let's just say that I factored in that if I pay $1,800 a year taxes for a car, that if I paid that for 10 years, it would be $18,000. If I paid that for 20 years, it would be $36,000. But what it will never be is the $80,000+ that they will want if I put $400,000 in the bank. What if I knew that I could cash in the car at any point and get that dollar amount for my car? At any point, would you pay the taxes per year, $1,800, or would you leave the $400,000 in the bank and have to pay over $80,000 for it? Because I could go through 40 years and I wouldn't pay the amount that I would need on taxes for the same dollar amount. When you see people with pictures in their house, this picture's $1 million. And you say, man, that Negro's stupid. Spending $1 million on a picture, but because it appraises for X amount of money, hey, does someone have to pay taxes on $1 million picture? That's a conversation we need to be in. Because maybe you don't want to put $1 million in the bank, because if you hang $1 million up on your wall, you may not have the same tax implication. So maybe people have found a way, and that's why I told you it costs too much money to be poor. Because a wealthy man can hang up his money on the wall and defer or make taxes null and void. But a poor man can't. A poor man can't hang up some shit on the wall to defer taxes. They're coming for you. Every little money you make. But a wealthy man saves more money than a poor man who has none. What kind of shit is that? I went into the store the other day and I got two free phones. And damn phone cost $1,600. Buy one, get one free. All I paid was the setup fee. Because my credit's so good. Man, hold the phone. Pay us back next year. Don't just take one, take a second one. And what they said about the third line, right?
Completely free of monthly payments.
For when? Till next year?
Forever.
Forever. I not only got one phone for $1,600, I got the second phone for free. And when that phone cost $1,600, I didn't have to pay $1,600 for either one of the two phones. Just activation fee and taxes. And my credit's so damn good that the third phone came for free for the rest of my life. And what did I say to you that I wanted you to do right with your phone? As far as the free phone goes.
Basically just add the line so that I never have to pay
so
a phone bill again.
So you never have to pay a bill again for the rest of your life. I said, since a bill don't have to be paid, it's a third phone. Just switch your phone over to this service over here and just keep the damn thing. And you'll never have to pay a bill again for the rest of your life. Now, I throw off the hustle to rent out my phone to someone and take a bill every month. I am a nigga from Brownsville. Shit don't change. You know what I'm saying? I did have a light bulb. The same thing said, I said, I said, wifey over here. I like, hopefully she's not getting no ideas. Gonna think I'm renting this shit. I damn sure was like, yo, I can rent the bill out for $30. You know, that accumulate for the rest of my life. I'm looking at it like, yo, I just gotta think like this. Because literally, I got the third phone, not only for free. No, the third phone I would have to pay for, or I could transfer a number to. But the service for now to the end of my days will be free.
Oh, yeah, basically you attach it to a phone number. And
that's it?
Once you attach that phone number to a phone, the phone bill, is, yeah, it's on the
And
bill.
Netflix.
Oh, and Netflix is on them.
For the rest of my life. All because my credit lit. Thanks, Black Card Bandits. But all because... All because, yo, I was sitting there and I said, nigga, we made it. I just be feeling away. Every time credit works out for me, it's like when I went to Ashley Furniture Company and they was like, yo, you want to see if you, what your credit line is like? And I'm like, man, I just got the stigma from all the times I got shut down. I'm waiting for people to move, so no one will say, man, you didn't get approved, you know? Because this is what they do, they talk too loud. And I just wait till everybody's out the way and I'm like, yo, go check. But because I was living on Wilshire Boulevard, one of the most wealthiest streets in America, a few blocks away from Rodeo Drive, because, you know, I moved on up and I live in Beverly Hills now. Just my address alone. They said, oh, Wilshire Boulevard, oh, you're approved for $5,000. Someone's allowed me to get $5,000. Pardon me, I've been a nigga for so many days in my life, I forgot shit changed. And I racked up. I got all this furniture, came back to the crib. They're like, damn, Dwight, yo, we told you don't spend all that brass. I said, baby, they gave me 5 G's. And if I need more, they give me more. What they give you 5 G's for? I said, no, we've been niggas for too long. This shit has changed. We really the kings and queens we was talking about back then. This shit done change. No one's seeing me as a nigga no more. This credit got people dealing with me. They looked at the white woman and told her she wasn't approved. Because they said it nice and loud so I can hear it. And I went over there, and I was just like, yo, how much of my credit line can I use today? And I looked at that white lady in disgrace, like, you white in America, and you not getting approved because of your credit, and I'm black, and they giving me the bag, you should be ashamed of yourself. After all that damn slavery, I should not have to drop on your ass with credit. That's how I'm feeling today. And I got me exceptional. I got me a damn. That's why I got a new baby now, man. I bought the bed that I probably made the baby to Ashley. I got to thank Ashley for my new baby. I done bought a bed, and light of me getting that bed, I made a baby. Goddamn, I was so happy. I was a wreck when they told me I had $5,000. I could come back and get another $5,000. I had to get that energy off.
Oh my God.
I'm just saying, when your credit get fixed, you feel a different way. That's all I'm saying. This ain't your typical commercial right here. This is some real shit I'm kicking with you. It's a burden. And even though I'm living that good now, I went through the same experience yesterday when I got the new phones. I keep forgetting I'm no longer a nigga no more. That classification's out of here. Your status changes. I told you that credit is a covert means to employ a class system. And depending on what your score is, you get certain privileges. It's still a class system. Facts. It's their way to know to alienate or ostracize people, maybe not by race, but by zip code. And by default, if you can alienate people by zip code, you can alienate them by race, because most races exist in clusters per zip code. So they're still being slipped. It's called credit card redlining. They got areas where it's like, if you're in the red, forget about it. They're not going to approve you the way they should, or they're not going to give you as much money as they should. So I finally got over the hurdle. And we making money now. Not only making money, the amount of money you looking to save under the mattress, you'll never be able to catch up to in credit. And everybody is using, let me tell you, the two places you can hide as far as taxes is concerned is insurance and real estate. Okay? The money is in credit, insurance, and real estate. That's where the big money is at. Stop trying to save up as much, stop saving up as much money as you can. Don't need the word try. Stop saving as much money as you can thinking it's going to do something for you. Because it's not. You got to get in the game. Get that credit right. If you got your credit right now, it takes but we say 2 to 3. I say a month and a half, 6 weeks, but it gets done inside of 2 to 3 weeks, and technically it gets done in 4 days, depending on what day of the week we get started. You get your credit fixed in the middle of this chaos. You get some credit cards at your disposal. You invest. You come out of this bitch healthy, safe, full of napkins. Because when you get approved for the credit cards and personal loans and business loans, you can go napkin shopping and tissue shopping galore. If that's what floats your damn boat, do it when you got a lot of money at your disposal. So I end with this. You see the email pinned to the top, brotherpolite45@gmail.com. You leave your full name and phone number with service you're interested in. You know I do the consultations. Once you make the payment for the consultation, to do it $200, $300, depending if it's over the phone or in person. But it probably won't be in person because of the corona scare. But, once you make the payment, I'll send you some questions. You forward the answers back to me in my evaluation. I'll be able to make an assessment, and then I'll be able to come to the table with a conversation, and that's how we optimize your experience, because I can easily play the game, get paid for a consultation, talk to you, and burn the time. I don't want to do that because it's not meant to be stimulating. I would rather help you. I would rather be challenged and find out what's going on and be able to add value to your life. There's no glory in talking to someone for an hour, faking the funk, because the conversation is going to feel like it's taking a longer time than it should. If I'm actually doing knowledge, that conversation is going to go by smoothly. So I'd rather find out what's going on with you, figure out your specific interests and needs, create a curriculum that caters to those specific interests and needs. And when we start the first minute forward of our consultation, we will both be the benefactors of that dialogue. Then that's how we perform, and that's how we have reciprocity. So that's the consultation. And then, you know, like I said, we got the credit restoration microwave, you know, and we'll help you set up the companies associated with it. We'll do all that. Just give us a holler, brotherpolite45@gmail.com, leave your full name, your phone number. When you see the economic part 3, I'm gonna release it on Instagram first. I'm gonna start putting this stuff up on YouTube. When you see the economic presentation, and the long version will be on Facebook, but the first version is gonna be on Instagram for 10 minutes, not exceeding. If you don't soak up that information and go straight to your computer and start making sure you make your little purchases on whatever it is you gotta do, your brain dead. Turn something in and start getting your silver. Turn something in, get your platinum. Turn something in, get your Ethereum, pay for your consultation. And more importantly, get the credit restoration, because that's gonna put you in a position to get the house. That's gonna put you in a position to get your six figures on and upwards. That's gonna put you in a position where at least if this shit hit the fan, you got these credit cards here at your disposal and everything, you can sit here and you can just watch how everything work. Because I mean, you might need to buy a gun, because guns are being sold at an alarming rate. Who knows? Maybe you might want to move out the neighborhood ASAP in the middle of this. You're going to get a property for dirt cheap in this hour. Facts. It's just things to think about. You can actually say you not only survived the coronavirus pandemic, but you came out with gold. You do the knowledge first, then you make the knowledge born, as we say. The nation of God's nervous, they make the knowledge born, you make that information applicable. For the application of knowledge is wisdom. Peace, God. But go ahead, I'll see y'all later. I love you guys. Appreciate y'all. Hope you had a great time. I know I stepped out of this light plenty of times. It's hard to stay still. I told you I might be suffering from them made up diseases that they say people be having. You know, I can't stay still. I'm fidgety when I got this information in me, but I call it spirit. The spirit make me like, I gotta move my legs when I'm talking. I can't just be here stationary. Yo, class, today we're gonna be doing this. This is null and void. I can't do that. And that's why I dropped out of school. It wasn't exciting. It wasn't stimulating. I wanna know that my teacher loves me. I wanna know that my teacher wants to connect with me on every level. I want to know that my teacher gives a damn about me. I want to know that my teacher is excited about the information and the potential that exists therewith. I want to feel like this is not a lie and that this person's speaking from experience. And shit, if it got him so happy, and yo, that sound like me at Ashley. I would like to make a baby to a new bed that I got off of credit. You know what I'm saying? Like, these are nigga dreams and ambitions. Until we start saying, I want to own the skyscraper. Let me be able to afford a $3,000 bed. You feel me? When your wife say, yo, did you just blow all the bread on a bed? I said, no, baby. I bought a bunch of bread, and I got the bed, and it all was on credit. See, that's a whole different conversation. You know what I'm saying? When you got ivory. What's that? What's the headboards? Ivory headboards. What the hell is a nigga doing with ivory headboards? I come from Brownsville. It's because my credit got fixed, goddammit. That's why. Yo, let me get off this. I'll talk to y'all later.